welcome to once again in the department of English, and you are going to study a very interesting poem which is prescribed at FYBA compulsory English semester 3. The title of the poem is My Heart Leaps Up, written by a very famous English poet named William Wordsworth. Now, first of all, let us have to see something about William Wordsworth, that what is his place in English literature. In short, we'll study first the some autobiographical hints about the poet. So he was born on the 7th of April 1770 and died on 23rd of April 1850. So he is known as the worshipper of nature, or in short we can say that he is the poet of nature. He has his own philosophy regarding the nature. For him, nature is our guide, nature is a nurse, nature is a teacher, and nature is a philosopher. So throughout his poetical work, he gave the same message or his views regarding the nature. Then, when we see the poetical work of William Wordsworth, that he is very famous for his book that is Preface to Lyrical Ballads. So this book, Preface to Lyrical Ballads, which was published in 1798, and this book is known as the Manifesto of English Romanticism. So in short we can say that the pioneer of English Romanticism is William Wordsworth. And in this book, that is Preface to Lyrical Ballad, he published the book with his dear friend S.T. Coleridge, that is Samuel Taylor Coleridge. And in the preface of that book, Wordsworth focused on the definition of poetry, the diction of poetry, and the subject of poetry. And his definition becomes very popular, that in the preface he says, what is poetry? It is the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings. It takes its origin from emotions recollected in tranquility. In short, we can say that poetry is the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings, and it's takes its origin from the emotions recollected in tranquility. That means what he experienced in the past, and then he writes the poem, the work or the poem. So very interesting definition he has given. When we see the life and career of William Wordsworth, we have a list of famous poems by this poet, such as the lines written a few miles above Tintern Abbey, The Solitary Reapers, composed upon Westminster Bridge, Daffodils, Ode to Intimations of Immortality, The Solitary Reaper, The World Is Too Much With Us, which is a sonnet, or The Prelude, or Ode to Duty, are some of his famous poems which are very popular in English literature. Now when we study the history of Romanticism, so what are the subjects of this romantic poetry, and who are the chief contributors of it? First of all, the poets like William Blake and William Wordsworth, they the French Revolution, there is a great impact of French Revolution on these poets. And the principles of French Revolution, that is liberty, equality and fraternity, these are the three principles of French Revolution. And in the literature, William Wordsworth, through this book, The Lyrical Ballad, which was published in 1798, that is why I say this book is a manifesto of English Romanticism. And here in literature, the poets of Romantic age, they enjoyed the liberty of the subject, the liberty of the language. First of all, before when we study the literary works or the poems of before the period of Romanticism, we find that the subjects of poetry, sometimes the gods and goddesses, the kings and the queens, the prince and the princess, the great warriors. But for the first time, William Shakespeare and his predecessors or the Romantic poets, they handled the subject that they take the nature is the chief source for their inspiration. Or they have taken the subjects from nature and they use the language of, that is the diction of common people. Common people become the subject of their poetry and common diction become the subject of their poetry. When we see the chief contributors, that who devoted themselves for the sake of Romanticism, we find that William Blake, William Wordsworth, Samuel Taylor Coleridge, Lord Byron, Percy Bysshe Shelley and John Keats. These are the major poets of English Romanticism. When we see the Romanticism in English literature, we find that there are certain principles or features of English Romanticism. That these poets have written their poems in a very simple diction, very simple essay language. Because they believe that the poetry should not come out from the brain. It should come from the heart so that it can touch the heart. And so the diction plays a very vital role in this matter. And all of these poets, from William Blake to John Keats, so all of these poets used very simple language or simple diction for their work. Then they prefer the subject of solitary life in the nature. They are the true worshippers of the natures. Suppose Percy Bysshe Shelley has written a poem on very natural objects, just like Ode to Skylark, Ode to West Wind, or we have Ode to Grecian Urn by John Keats. Okay, so William Wordsworth has written a poem on the very wild flower named as daffodils. So the simple subjects, simple language, so it appeals to the average reader, common reader, or even uneducated people even also. In the work of Romantic poetry, we find that imagination, they usually think that imagination is superior to reasons, and especially the focus of their work or focus of their poems are on imagination and feelings of human life. Even the feelings and emotions of the other natural objects are also reflected in their poetry. Now I come to the poem which is prescribed for your study, which is very interesting one. First of all, it is when we see the type of poetry, we find that this is a lyric, but this short lyrics gives a philosophy of life. So in short, we can say this is a philosophical lyric written by William Wordsworth, the romantic poet. The poem was written on 26th of March 1802 and which was published in 1807. This is a very short poem which contains only 9 lines. But within these 9 lines, Wordsworth expresses the philosophy of life. Now let us have to study this poem line by line. The first lines describes, the poet expresses that who is the speaker of this poem? The poet William Wordsworth is himself the speaker of the poem. It means, and the various literary devices how used in the poem is also a matter of study as far as this poem is concerned. The poem has first person narration. So when we read the first line, that is my heart, that means poet is going to tell himself, and he says my heart lifts up. Now here we have a metaphorical description of poet's heart. What poet says? My heart lifts up. What is lifts up? That is springs up or thrill with joy. So this is the half part. So in this half part of the first line, the poet says, my heart lifts up when I behold. So this is the remaining part of sentence. What is this behold? Behold means look at. Now, in short we can say, the poet says, my heart lifts up when I behold, when I look at. But where? What? The questions are, we have the questions. And to get the answer, we have to read the next line of the poem, which says, a rainbow in the sky. So here, the natural object is taken to describe his happiness of or joy of his heart. The poet says, when I see rainbow in the sky, in the open sky. Again you see why Wordsworth is called a nature poet. This is the best example. When the poet sees the rainbow in the sky, his heart, we can say, springs up or thrill with joy. Thrill with happiness, limitless happiness, we can say, when he notices the rainbow in the sky. So rainbow, it is a multicolored natural object, okay, and it shows the colorful life of human being, and it is very difficult to decide which color ends and which color starts at a particular line. So they are mixed with together, we can say. Still, it has separate existence, we can say. While in the third line of the poem, the poet say, so was it when my life began. Here, the poet first says that when I behold the rainbow, that means this is a common experience, he says, about his life. But the third line describes that so was it when my life began. And when the poet says, when my life began, that means he is going to tell us about his childhood. So when the life of human being begins, that is at childhood. So here, childhood experience the poet describes. Now the poet is not child enough. He is a young man. But here, the flashback technique is used. What he is going to tell is, it is about the childhood experience. So flashback technique is used. Poet takes us to his childhood and he says it was his experience, that means to see or to observe, to notice the rainbow in the sky. It is not a unfamiliar with this poet, or it is the poet is experienced with this rainbow when he was child, and he gets happiness because the first line says his heart lifts up when he sees the when he notices when he observes the rainbow in the sky, and he had the same experience when he was a child. While the next line say, now the same experience he gets. That is why the poet says, so as it, there is no change. Now, this now indicates the present. That means in the third line, he describes about the past, that is his childhood. And this word, now I am. Again, the present tense is used. I am a man. Now I am fully matured person. Now I am an adult. Now this is my present. And the poet says, I reap the happiness of the natural objects when I was a child. The same I experience in my present. While in the next line, he focuses on his future. And the poet says, so be it when I shall grow old. Means here, future of the human being is described. What is life after all? It is a combination. Just like the rainbow have multicolor, we have this experience of life when we study our life or what is our life. It is a mixture of past, present and future. Okay, but the poet says, now poet is an adult person. Now he is a mature person. He describes his past and he also describes his future. That means the poem is in the present tense. Okay, because now he is a mature person. So he says, so be it when I shall grow old. He says, in the past, at my childhood, I reap the happiness of natural look at the natural objects just like the rainbow. I get the same happiness in the present, and I'll get the same experience when I would grow old. And if the next line is very important, the poet says, it describes the importance of nature in human life. And the next line says, or let me die. The poet says, if I am fails to enjoy the beauty of the nature when I would be old person, then it is better to die. I would prefer to die when I fails to enjoy the nature, which describes the importance of nature in human's life. That is, nature is the part and parcel of our life. That is why William Wordsworth used to say, O lady, we receive and what we give, and in our life does nature live. So nature is the inseparable part of human life. Real, in real sense, I say. So all of these things are described up to this part of the poem. While the next line, which is a very famous quotation, which shows the paradox. And what is that? The poet says, the child is the father of man. Now this is a contradictory statement. It shows two opposite ideas together. The child is the father of man. Means whatever the man is in the present, it is the product of his childhood. How you we can say devote your childhood, your manhood is depend on it. Because as a child, it has also the biblical references even also. So the poet says that just like our character is molded when we are a child. Or we can say the manhood, the father is the enlarged vision of childhood. Okay, whatever the our setup of our mind is reflected in our past. Again, the childhood is the experience of past and father is the experience of present. That means our present describes what was our past. And while the next line, in the last two lines, the poet gives us the summing of the poem, and he says, and I could wish my days to be. That means he started to think about his future life, and then he says, bound each to each. This each to each is very important, that my life and the nature, they should be bound each to each, must not be separate from each other, by not with a rope, not by with the not by the chain, not by the rule, but by natural piety. This, what is piety? Piety, again, it is a religious, it has religious connotation, which describes the faithfulness of the person. And here, the poet never describes the religious connotation, I think, but this natural piety, it describes the importance of nature in our day-to-day's life. So here the poem ends. When we study the poem, there are a number of questions arises in front of us. First of all, that the title of the poem is not given by the poet. My heart lifts up. This is the first line of the poem. So sometime, some says the title of the poem is My Heart Lifts Up. While some other things that the title of the poem is Rainbow. While some says the paradoxical statement, the child is the father of the man, is the title of the poem. It describes, when we see the theme of the poem, we find that the nature, the importance of nature, or we can say how nature is a source of boundless joy of human being, is described in this poem. It describes the intimate relationship between human being and nature. The poem describes the response or love for nature. That is, he sees the rainbow in the sky, and the poet, how the poet respond to that rainbow is described in this poem. It also describes the intense and sincere love of nature in this poem. The pure, enthusiastic reaction to the natural world or the rainbow is described in this poem. Though the poet, it is not unknown experience, that is the experience of the rainbow. It is not new for him, because he already reaped this happiness when he was a child. The poem gives his emotions and feelings a meaning, we say, the meaning of life. Here, in this poem, the poet recollects or remembers the experience of his childhood days, and it has the connection with the past, present and future, with the perpetual joy. I see the poet glides from past to present and present to future, but the poem begins in the present tense, and the poet hopes to maintain this childlike enthusiasm for the natural world. As far as the diction of this poem is concerned, it is so simple. There is hardly a difficult word in this poem. We have the personification in the title is this is given, that is my heart lifts up. When non-human things are described as having the human attributes, it is, we say, personification, which we see in the title of the poem. Certain metaphors are also used in this poem. That metaphor is used to describe an object, person, or we can say situation or any action in a way that helps to reader to understand it without using like or as. Here in the poem, especially in the first two lines, we have assonance and consonants are used. What is assonance? That is a repetition of the vowel sound within a group of words. And in the first two lines, we have the sound E is repeated. My heart leap up when I behold, like this. Or we have the consonants. Consonants. What is consonants? This is the repetition of same consonant sound within a group of words. For example, here in these two lines, the sound P as well as B is repeated. You see, my heart leaps P, up P, when I behold. So P and B consonant is repeated. We have enjambment is used in this poem. What is this enjambment? Means it is the we can say continuation of a sentence or clause across a line break. That is, when we read the first line, we never get the meaning of the poem, because the first line, my heart lifts up when I behold, when I look. But what? We have to read the second line. So here enjambment is used. We have paradoxical statement, which I already referred, that child is the father of man. When we see the rhyme scheme of this poem, we find A B C C A B C D D is the rhyme scheme of this poem. So I hope that you like this poem, the interesting poem which is prescribed at your for your study. Thank you to spare time with me.